وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم اجعل تجمعنا هذا تجمعا مرحوما، وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تجعل فينا ولا بيننا شقيا ولا محروما، إنك ولي ذلك من قادر عليه. In the last session we reached the ayah 100. أَوَكُلَّمَا جَاءَكُمْ أَوَكُلَّمَا عَاهَدُوا عَهْدًا نَبَذَهُ فَرِيقٌ مِّنْهُمْ بَلْ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking about the Israelites, that every time they give a covenant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they negate this covenant, they do not live up to it. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking again of the final, the seal prophet that he has sent. وَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ مُصَدِّقٌ لِمَا مَعَهُمْ نَبَذَ فَرِيقٌ مِّنَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَرَاءَ ظُهُورِهِمْ كَأَنَّهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. When the Prophet ﷺ has come to them, and they were in anticipation of this Prophet, and this Prophet did not come with anything different from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent with Musa and Isa عليهم الصلاة والسلام. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, when the Prophet has come to you and you are anticipating him, and there is a detailed and meticulous description of who this prophet is in the Torah, and he is confirming that which you believe in already. He is confirming that which you believed in already. You rejected him and you rejected the revelation. In that you rejected Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you rejected the Quran. واتبعوا ما تتلو الشياطين على ملك سليمان. It's inevitable that one rejects the truth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what they're going to follow. They're going to follow falsehood. Because anything and everything aside from the straight path, aside from the guidance, is a misguidance. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, as a just recompense, he has deviated them from the straight path because of their very own actions. واتبعوا ما تتلو الشياطين على ملك سليمان وما كفر سليمان ولكن الشياطين كفروا يعلمون الناس السحر. These are very interesting ayat. They talk about magic, and magic not in the magic in the sense that we see sometimes on TV where somebody has a light hand and they're able to move things without you noticing because of the speed of their hand and so on and so forth. Here we're talking about black magic that is being taught by Satans. And the word shaitan, it refers to any type of creation that's been corrupted. So there's the shaitan of al-jinn, meaning that they're corrupted among the jinn. And there's the shaitan of the ins, meaning that they're corrupted among the ins. And there's the shaitan of the animals, meaning that they're corrupted among the animals. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّبَعُوا مَا تَتْلُوا الشَّيَاطِينُ عَلَى مُلْكِ سُلَيْمَانِ. عَلَى مُلْكِ سُلَيْمَانِ means that at the time of Solomon, at the time of Sulaiman alayhi salam. Black magic has been prevalent in humanity for thousands and thousands of years. And it was very prevalent at the time of Sulaiman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given Sulaiman kingship and prophethood. And he was among very, very few prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was given kingship and prophethood at the same time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put to Sulaiman the jinn at his service, and the wind, and the birds, and you know, so on and so forth, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him such a kingdom that he has not given to anybody else in the past. So the Israelites believe that Sulaiman has reached this status of being a king by way of practicing black magic. But of course, by no stretch of the imagination, a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would practice, you know, black magic. What he was practicing is basically the miracles that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put at his service. Meaning that he could see the jinn, he could speak to them, he could interact with them, he could speak to the birds, he could speak to the ants, so on and so forth. But no one else could understand that language, no one else could see the jinn, except Sulaiman alayhi salam. So people have thought that Sulaiman alayhi salam is practicing black magic. Why? Because black magic was pretty prevalent at the time, and people would do things and would use the Satans from among the jinn, and the Satans from among the ins, you know, people, and they would practice, you know, sorcery. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exonerating Sulaiman alayhi salam from any kufr whatsoever, because as we know, according to the Sharia of Islam, engaging oneself in learning black magic or practicing black magic is an act of kufr. Means that there is no way that someone could learn black magic except that they first have to reject the faith. have to exit the state of Islam if they were Muslims and enter into a state of apostasy. Why? Because it would entail. It entails what? It entails dealing with Satans. And the story of Satans is that, from among the jinn, is that they used to climb on top of one another until they reached the heavens. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees, the annual part of al-qada wal-qadr, he would speak to Jibreel alayhi salam. And then, as he tells us in Surah Sabah, حتى إذا فزع عن قلوبهم قالوا ماذا قال ربكم قالوا الحق. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoken to Jibreel alayhi salam, nobody else could hear. And then when Jibreel alayhi salam wanted to relate what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spoken and has decreed to the angels in order to execute these orders, they would say what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. What did he say? قَالُوا الْحَقِّ. He said, he spoke in the truth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is one of his 99 names, is Al-Haq. And then they would carry on. So the Satans who climbed up to the heavens, and at that time, the heavens was not guarded. They were not guarded. Okay? Because later, we learned from the Qur'an, وَأَنَّا كُنَّا نَقْعُدُ مِنْهَا مَقَاعِدَ لِلسَّمْعِ فَمَنْ يَسْتَمِعِ الْآنَ يَجِدْ لَهُ شِهَابًا رَصَدًا وَأَنَّا لَمَسْنَا السَّمَاءَ فَوَجَدْنَاهَا مُلِئَتْ حَرَسًا شَدِيدًا وَشُهُبًا. That when we used to sit in the good old days and listen to the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being passed on from Jibreel alayhi salam to the angels, would catch some of that. We would capture some of this information and they would teach it to their allies from the satans of humans. And the satans of the humans would do what? They would take this information, they would manipulate it, they would add to it, so on and so forth, in order to what? In order to claim that they know the unknown. And in order to claim that they can benefit people, and they can tell them what's coming to them in the future, and they can help them have children if they cannot have children, and they can help them get rid of their debts, and they can help them, you know, increase their sustenance, so on and so forth. And all of these are acts of kufr. All of these are acts of kufr. Because to come close to Satans from among the jinn, you have to disgrace the Quran. You have to use blasphemy. You have to speak ill of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have to slaughter for them. Whatever it is, a cat, a dog, any animal, you have to slaughter for them. Why? Because they're trying to basically act as if they are deities. And slaughtering only belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made, you know, lawful and permissible. So to come close to the Satans of jinn, one must reject the faith and enter a state of apostasy. So, وَأَنَّا كُنَّا مَقْعُدُ مِنْهَا مَقَاعِدَ لِلسَّمْعِ فَمَنْ يَسْتَمِعِ الْآنَ يَجِدْ لَهُ شِهَامًا رَصَدًا. So, Satans continued to climb up to the heavens, and now they see that it's heavily guarded. So they said something has changed. When did that happen? It happened with the sending of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. So the heavens became guarded, and as we read in the Quran, in a number of ayat, in Surah Al-Jinn and others, a tribe from among the jinn, they said something has definitely changed in the universe. And what has changed is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his final prophets. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that بُعِثْتُ وَالسَّاعَ هَكَذَا. I was sent with the hour like this. يعني بُعِثْتُ وَحَامِلَ الْبُوقِ. And the one who carries the trumpet has leaned forward to blow in the trumpet. So we can see how close we are to the end of time. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he went to deliver the message to Bani Ta'if, and they've rejected the message and they've sent the foolish ones among them to harass the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to throw stones at him and to, you know, call him names and so on and so forth, he was able to escape, and then he reached a place called Wadi Nakhla, the valley of the palm tree. He sat there and he began to recite the Quran. In the latter part of Surah Al-Ahqaf, we read Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, وإذ صرفنا إليك نفرا من الجن يستمعون القرآن فلما حضروه قالوا أنصتوا فلما قضي ولوا إلى قومهم منذرين. And when we have sent you all, Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, نفرا من الجن, a group of the jinn, يستمعون القرآن, to listen to the Quran, meaning that this Quran is not just for us, it's also for the world of jinn. So whoever obeys among us enters paradise, and whoever disobeys enters the hellfire. Similarly for the world of jinn. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent them to listen to the Quran. فَلَمَّا حَضَرُوهُ قَالُوا أَنْصِتُوا. When they reached the Prophet ﷺ and they heard him reciting the Quran, they said, listen, ansitu, listen attentively. فَلَمَّا قُضِيَ When the Prophet ﷺ finished, وَلَّوْ إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِمْ مُنْدِرِينَ They went back to their people, given warnings. قَالُوا يَا قَوْمَنَا إِنَّا سَمِعْنَا كِتَابًا أُنْزِلَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مُوسَى مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ يَهْدِي إِلَىٰ الْحَقِّ وَإِلَىٰ طَرِيقٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ That we have heard a book revealed after Musa alayhi salam, guides to the truth, affirming what Musa alayhi salam has come with, guiding to the truth and guiding to the straight path. يَا قَوْمَنَا أَجِيبُ دَاعِيَ اللَّهِ All our people respond favorably to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ مِنْ ذُنُوبِكُمْ وَيُجِرْكُمْ مِنْ عَذَابِ الْأَلِيمِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive your sins and He will protect you from a severe torment. A severe torment. So we can see that the Qur'an is not just for people, it's also for the world of jinn. It's also for the world of jinn. At the time of Solomon, just to backtrack a little bit, he gathered all of the writings of the sorcerers. And he gathered them and he dug up a hole under his throne and he buried them. And he said, whoever among the jinn approaches this will burn. And whoever among humans approaches this, I will kill him. So when Sulaiman alayhi salam passed away, of course, some of these sorcerers continued to claim that Sulaiman alayhi salam was a kafir, wal-iyadu billah, and that he taught black magic and he benefited from black magic and all of that. So Satan came to them in the form of a human being and he said, under the throne of Solomon is what has caused him to reach this high status. Dig up the hole, and if you don't find anything, kill me. If I'm lying to you, kill me. They said, why don't you dig up the hole? He said, I cannot dig up the hole. Why? Because the promise of Solomon was still in place. Any member of the jinn approaches this hole will burn. But he died, so anybody from the humans, from people approaches the hole, nothing will happen to him. So they dug it up, and they got these books, and they continued to practice that. And there was much black magic practice at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, to the extent that the Prophet ﷺ himself was harmed. The Prophet ﷺ himself was harmed when a man by name Labib, you know, has gathered some of the hair of the Prophet ﷺ from a comb, and then he began, you know, to do his black magic on it, and to blow on it, and tie knots in a rope, and to blow and tie knots, and so on and so forth. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, وَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مِنْهُمَا مَا يُفَرِّقُونَ بِهِ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجِهِ And they learn by way of these practices that which puts between a man and his wife, a man and his spouse. And this is what they've done to the Prophet ﷺ to some degree. Is that Aisha radiallahu anha used to say that the Prophet ﷺ, when they did the black magic to him, كَانَ يُخَيِّرُ لَهُ أَنَّهُ يَأْتِي أَهْلَهُ It was, he imagined that he was leading a normal spousal life and that he would have intimate relationships with his spouses, while in reality he did not. But that is the extent of their magic. And of course he suffered from some, you know, pains and aches and things of that nature. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who allowed for this, only with his permission, that allowed for this to affect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's done so for tremendous wisdom. And that wisdom, part of what we grasp onto, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descended the cure in the Qur'an. And that is Surah قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ Surah Al-Falaq وَقُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ Surah Al-Nas. So the angels descended with, Jibreel alayhi salam descended with this, with these two surahs. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Jibreel to inform the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam where these knots were. So he sent the sahaba to the well, where Labib threw the knots in the well. They retrieved this, you know, black magic that he had done, and they began to read these mu'awwidatan, Surah Al-Falaq and Surah Al-Nas, upon the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and began to untie these knots, and then as a result the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was cured. Now, just a side note here, and I mention this because the enemies of Islam, you know, try to find any entry into the Qur'an, anything that is not so clear in our minds, to attack the Qur'an and to attack the Prophet ﷺ and say, you see, you know, he was hallucinating. He imagined things. Aisha says though. But the reality is if you have the information from the Qur'an and from the Sunnah, you're in a better position to respond. If you're not in a position to respond, what's going to happen? They're going to create doubt in your mind. Or you're going to say that didn't happen, but in reality it did. It did happen. So this is information. Al-ilmu nur. Knowledge is a guiding light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as a result, was cured. Okay? We come to one other issue here that needs a bit of an explanation. In the ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاتَّبَعُوا مَا تَتْلُوا الشَّيَاطِينُ عَلَى مُلْكِ سُلَيْمَانَ وَمَا كَفَرَ سُلَيْمَانَ وَلَكِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ كَفَرُوا يُعَلِّمُونَ النَّاسَ السِّحْرَ. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after exonerating Sulaiman from committing any kufr, he's referring to the shayateen, يُعَلِّمُونَ النَّاسَ السِّحْرَ. They teach them blasphemy. They teach them how to disgrace the Quran. They teach them that which they stole from al-ghayb, right? They teach them just the tricks of the trade, if you will, right? And then after that, وَمَا أُنزِلَ عَلَى الْمَلَكَيْنِ بِبَابِلَ هَارُوتَ وَمَارُوتَ. This letter, ma, mim, alif, okay? Some of the scholars said this is for negating that anything, any black magic was descended on Harut and Marut. In other words, they said it's either ma al-wasl or ma al-nafi. If it's ma al-nafi, it's a ma of negation. If it's ma al-wasl, meaning that they learned black magic and they also learned that which was revealed on al-malakain, the two angels, Harut and Marut. Now, a lot of people had issues with these two ayat. Some will say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not descend black magic on two angels. So therefore, these were not two angels, they were not malakain with the fatha on the la, they are malikain with the kasra under the la. So imagine, malikain, two kings in Babel, the old, you know, capital of Iraq, right? Teaching people black magic, meaning that these malikain, whether they're kings or they're regular human beings, whatever the case might be, that they're teaching people black magic. Well, we know that somebody who teaches people black magic is what? It's a kafir. But the ayat say, what? إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ فِتْنَةٌ فَلَا تَكْفُرُ. That we are fitna, we are trial for you, so do not commit kufr. So how could someone who is a disbeliever tell you that I'm a fitna for you, do not become a disbeliever? It doesn't add up. Plus Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? وَمَا أُنزِلَ عَلَى الْمَلَكَيْنِ بِبَابِلَ هَارُوتَ وَمَارُوتَ وَمَا يُعَلِّمَانِ. يُعَلِّمَانِ with alif al-ithnain. Double plural in the Arabic language. It refers to the angels. So how can you negate that? How can you say it's ma al-nafiyah, the ma of negation? It doesn't add up. It just conflicts. Here's the missing puzzle, if you will. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of in terms of black magic that descended or that was taught by the Satans, it is not the magic that descended upon the two angels. What does that mean? We mentioned the first part that was descended, that was taught by the Satans, is sorcery. It's black magic. It's evil. It's blasphemy. It's slaughtering for committing shirk. Disgracing the Quran. You know, all of these, you know, evil acts. What was descended on al-Malakain is like an idea. Just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has tested us with many other trials. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created for us grapes and created for us other fruits and dates and so on and so forth. And He also created in our minds an idea as to how to turn this into alcohol. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create alcohol. In other words, you cannot find a tree out there that has got a bottle of alcohol on it to grow in, or a bottle of wine or anything like that. But the idea is there. Similarly for tobacco, similarly for narcotics. You can use them a good use, or you can use them for an evil use. Similarly, this black, you know, this magic that descended upon the two angels, Harut and Marut, the scholars say that is ilm rabbani nurani. Means that is a divine knowledge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that has a lot of good in it. But where's the catch? The catch is that if you begin learning this knowledge, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, at the tongue of the two angels, وَمَا يُعَلِّمَانِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ, as they teach them, say, we are a fitna, we are a trial, do not learn this. It's going to lead to that which is kufr. Just like, do not be in seclusion with a woman that is stranger to you, because sooner or later you're going to fall into adultery. Okay? So the idea was created, and if you will, it's like raw materials. In other words, leave it alone. But some people say, no, I want to learn it. And I'm going to stop right there. But the angels are saying, إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ فِتْنَا فَلَا تَكْفُرُ. We are a trial, do not commit kufr. Means that sooner or later you're going to be competing with the other forces. Because you're going to have the ability to put, you know, to use basically the power of your mind and the power of the planets and the power of, you know, certain things. You've learned these tricks of the trade, and now you're competing with who? Who are your competitors? Those who have learned black magic. So you're going to begin to compete with them. And within us, we have the love to compete. We have the love to compete. And that which would yield a person to exit the state of Islam into a state of kufr. So you can see that the two are not the same. And that's why some people have sort of like really misinterpreted these ayat, because they fail to understand that what descended on Harut and Marut is not what was taught by the Satans. وَمَا يُعَلِّمَانِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ حَتَّى يَقُولَ إِنَّمَا نَحْنُ فِتْنَةٌ فَلَا تَكْفُرْ فَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مِنْهُمَا مَا يُفَرِّقُونَ بِهِ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجِهِ. We live in a state of fear sometimes because of our weak iman, because of our lack of understanding of the Quran, because of lack of understanding of the Sunnah. So anytime you see somebody who is a kahin, you know, a sorcerer, we get scared. Anybody who says, you know, I like, you know, your eyes, or I like, you know, your car, or I like your home. Oh, this is evil eye. This is that. So what do people start doing? They moved away from the Sunnah, and they start moving towards the bid'ah. So you'll find that people would wear the eye, and they would wear a tamima, and they would put things in their homes that are just completely fictitious. Or they would go to somebody who can, after drinking a cup of coffee and things dry up, they can read the future for you. Or they would go to someone who's, you know, got rings, you know, just, you know, impoverished and just got a few rings. Oh, you want to have children? Put this ring on. It'll cost you this much. Put this ring on, get rid of your debts. Put this ring on, this good will happen to you. But in reality, it's all ignorance. It's all bid'ah. It's all acts of shirk. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مَا يَضُرُّهُمْ وَلَا يَنْفَعُهُمْ. They learn that which harms them and does not benefit them. What does that mean? You look at the sorcerers. They live in the worst places. They live in the hell of this dunya. They are so impoverished, they can never hold a job. They can never hold a career. They can never hold, you know, status, you know, have a business. So you're always feeding, they're like maggots. You know, they're always feeding on others. You know, they're always feeding on the ignorance of others. They can not cause you any harm, and they cannot benefit you any. Because we know that harm and benefits can only be deterred by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or brought forth by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مَا يُفَرِّقُونَ بِهِ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجِهِ. And then he follows this statement by saying, وَمَا هُمْ بِضَارِّينَ بِهِ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. Even though they learn that which they put between spouses, right? But they cannot harm anybody except with the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 2 points I want to conclude with. The first of which, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us in the Quran and in the hadith how to protect ourselves. By way of adhkar al-sabah, adhkar al-masa, dua when you go to bed, the adhkar when you go to bed, adhkar when you wake up, adhkar when you enter the house, when you leave the house, when you enter the bathroom, when you have intimate relationships with your spouse, when, all these adhkar fortify you. I'll share one story with you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, اِقْرَأُوا الْبَقَرَ فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَسْتَطِيرُهَا الْبَطَرَ. اِقْرَأُوا الْبَقَرَ. Read Surah Al-Baqarah, because those who practice black magic, the sorcerers, cannot overcome this, cannot overcome Al-Baqarah. A person who comes from a wealthy family, you know, wanted to marry this young lady who was very religious, very committed. And she said, all I want is somebody who's committed, just as committed as I am, or at least close to that. So they said, you know, this man, you know, he prays, but, you know, he's sort of like, not really very religious. So she said, no, I don't want this. So this man thought about it. He said, how dare she would reject somebody like me? How dare she would reject somebody like me? So where does he resort to? He went to, you know, a kahin, somebody who practiced black magic. And he said, by the way, the most two popular black magic types are as-sarf wal-atf. The sarf is to put between two people, al-atf is to bring two people together. Okay? So part of a sarf to put between two people is that Satans would actually intervene, and if one is to look at his spouse, and this has happened repeatedly, they would see somebody who's awful. They would see somebody who's scary. When it comes to having intimate relationships with them, they can't. There's nothing wrong with them, but they cannot perform. So this is one way which, similar to it, was done to the Prophet ﷺ. Al-atf is sort of like to make somebody crush on another person. Okay? So he went to this, you know, magician, and he said, I want you to do something to make this woman want me. He said, no problem, but she's going to cost you. He said, no problem. He said, come back tomorrow. So the guy started doing his tricks and using, you know, the world of jinn, the Satans from among the jinn. And so when the guy went to him next time, he said, there's nothing I can do for you, but I would suggest you go step it up a little bit, and there's this person who is, you know, more advanced than I am. So he said, okay, no problem. He went to this other person, and he said, told him the same story, and the person did the same thing. He said, it's going to cost you, because obviously you go up in the class, if you will, or in this case, you go down, because it's darakat, it's not really going up. It's going to cost you more. So he went to this person, and he said, told him the same thing. He said, come back tomorrow, but it's going to cost you this much. He said, no problem. Came back the next day. He said, there's nothing I can do for you. Go back, you know, go to this other person. He's really well advanced, and he has very close relationships with Satan. Because it's a pyramid, if you will. It's like a ladder you climb on until you meet the head of the lowest of the low, and that is Satan, Iblis ta'anahu Allah. So he went to this guy, and of course the price is much higher. He says, it's going to cost you a fortune. He said, you name your price, I want her. He said, no problem, come back tomorrow. So the man listened, and he went back the second day, and the guy said, نجوم السماء أقرب إليك من هذه المرأة. He said, the stars in the heavens are closer for you than this woman. What is the story of this woman? This woman would recite Surah Al-Baqarah every night before she goes to bed. This woman recites Surah Al-Baqarah every night before she goes to bed. And we know from the hadith that whoever recites Surah Al-Baqarah, you know, at home, Satan will not enter that house for 3 days. And of course, the hadith that we just mentioned, recite Surah Al-Baqarah, فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَسْتَطِيعُهَا الْبَطَلَةَ, meaning that these, you know, sorcerers cannot deal with Surah Al-Baqarah. It is too powerful for them, you know, to deal with. We'll conclude with this ayah. وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ آمَنُوا وَاتَّقَوْا لَمَثُوبَةٌ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. Indeed, had they believed and practiced righteousness and taqwa, the reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this dunya and the hereafter is certainly much better for them. لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ, if they only knew. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. If anybody has any questions, I'll gladly stay here and answer their questions or any comments they may have. جزاك الله خيرا. السلام عليكم.